थँक्यू सर. मी सर्व मान्यवर आदरणीय डॉक्टर पंकज कुमार सर, माननीय देसाई साहेब, डॉक्टर प्रमोद पाब्रीकर सर, आमचे सहसंचालक आदरणीय डॉक्टर संजयजी जगताप सर, डॉक्टर प्रशांत राव सर, सर्व महाविद्यालयांचे प्राचार्य डॉक्टर साळुंके सर, डॉक्टर शरद महाजन सर, डॉक्टर ए एस कुलकर्णी सर आणि आमच्या सर्वांचेच मेंटॉर माननीय विनायक दळवी सर, विविध महाविद्यालयातून या ठिकाणी आलेले प्राध्यापक आणि विद्यार्थी बंधू भगिनींना मी शिक्षक दिनाच्या हार्दिक शुभेच्छा देतो. मित्र हो, मी फार याच्यावरती बोलणार नाही, एक दोनच फक्त वाक्य मी बोलेन आणि नंतर मी माझ्या विषयाला सुरुवात करेन. शिक्षक हा देश घडवतो, कारण देशाला लागणारी जी मॅनपॉवर आहे वेगवेगळ्या सेक्टरमधली, ती सगळी मॅनपॉवर उभं करण्याचं काम, स्किल्ड ह्युमन रिसोर्स आपण ज्याला म्हणतो, तो उभं करण्याचं काम शिक्षक करत असतात आणि त्याच्यातून देश उभा राहत असतो. मित्र, शिक्षक कसा असावा किंवा कसा असला पाहिजे, कारण शिक्षक कसा असावा हा शिक्षक जसा ठरवतो, तसा शिक्षक कसा असावा हे शासन ठरवतं आणि वेगवेगळ्या शिक्षण संस्था ठरवत असतात. आणि म्हणून मला असं वाटतं की शिक्षक हा एखादा चित्रपटामध्ये काम करणारा हिरो असतो, त्या पद्धतीनं तो राहतो, कारण या चित्रपटातल्या हिरोला काही संवाद दिले जातात, ते बंदिस्त केले जातात एका रीलमध्ये, आणि ज्या ज्यावेळी ज्या ज्या थिएटरला ते पिक्चर लावायचं असतं त्या त्या वेळी ती रील चालत राहते आणि तो हिरो जमलेल्या प्रेक्षकांबरोबर एक मार्गी संवाद साधत असतो. मित्रांनो, दुसऱ्या प्रकारचे शिक्षक अशा पद्धतीचे असू शकतात की जसा एखाद्या नाटकाचा रंगमंच असावा आणि त्या रंगमंचावरती काम करणारा कलाकार असावा की जो कलावंत आपल्या शैलीनं संवाद फेक त्या जमलेल्या सर्व प्रेक्षकांच्या समोर करत असतो आणि जेव्हा प्रेक्षकांना त्याचे संवाद भावतात तेव्हा कडाडून टाळ्यांचा प्रचंड असा आवाज येतो आणि जेव्हा तो आवाज येत असतो तेव्हा या कलावंताची कला ही फुलत असते आणि त्याच्या तोंडी डायरेक्टरनं न दिलेला संवाद देखील तो अचानकपणे बोलू शकतो की जे प्रेक्षकांना हवे असतात, ज्याच्यातून प्रेक्षक घडत असतात, समाज घडत असतो. बंधूंनो, मला वाटतं की शिक्षक हा अशा प्रकारचा असावा की तो बंदिस्त चित्रपटातल्या हिरोसारखा नसावा, तर तो रंगमंचावरती जिवंत काम करणाऱ्या कलावंतासारखा असावा. मला निश्चितपणे खात्री आहे की या देशातील सर्व नागरिक, या देशातले सर्व ॲडमिनिस्ट्रेटर्स, या देशातल्या सगळ्या शिक्षण संस्थांचे प्रमुख हे अशा पद्धतीचे शिक्षक तयार करण्यासाठी निश्चितपणे आपल्याला सगळ्यांना मार्गदर्शन करतील. मी पुन्हा एकदा आपल्या सर्वांचं मनपूर्वक आभार मानतो आणि शिक्षक दिनाच्या हार्दिक शुभेच्छा देतो आणि या ठिकाणी मी थांबतो. मी माझं आजच्या विषयाचं जे व्याख्यान आहे ते व्याख्यान सुरुवात करतो. धन्यवाद. मला माझा स्क्रीन शेअर करायची परवानगी मिळू शकेल का दर्शना मॅडम?
यस सर, यस सर. सर परमिशन दिली आहे.
ओके ओके. थँक्यू फ्रेंड्स. नाउ टुडे See, I am, first of all, I should thank all the coordinators of three colleges for giving me opportunity to interact with all the students on the topic Project Tiger, an umbrella for wildlife protection. Friends, though this topic is very general, but this topic is having certain meaning. So here I have shown the picture of a tiger who is jumping. Now here, all the three colleges, two model degree colleges and Pendleton College, have come together and they have taken jump just like tiger in the field of education for the welfare of entire student community and giving a specific direction to all the stakeholders in the education system. Second reason is this, that tigers, they usually occupy the topmost position in the nature. And if they survive, automatically entire biodiversity will survive. And if biodiversity survives, then and then only human being will survive. So it is a matter of existence of human being. And that's why I have chosen this general, very general topic, but very important topic of Project Tiger, an umbrella for wildlife protection. Here, friends, since the existence of human being, man has become non-separable part of the nature. Here, you know that there are several ecosystems in the nature, and these ecosystems, they are actually of different types. See, before starting with my lecture, I'm just taking you all back to the background of this topic, why we have chosen this particular topic and what is the importance of Project Tiger. Here, in the nature, man has been the nucleus. Man has been nucleus in the entire nature and in almost all the ecosystems. See, these ecosystems, they're actually of different types, aquatic and terrestrial, among the terrestrial systems, you may have the desert ecosystem or the grassland ecosystem or the forest ecosystem. If you consider any ecosystem, you will come to know that the ecosystem becomes more and more stronger, more and more complex if there are well-established food chains in them. Now, in all the food chains, very basic component, they are the plants, they are the producers, because they're having ability to capture the sunlight, solar energy, and convert it into the food energy by the way of photosynthesis. Here, the rest of the biological components of all the ecosystems, they do not have such type of ability to convert solar energy into food. And that's why we call all remaining animals as the consumers. And among the consumers, there are several tropic levels, such as the first tropic level or second tropic level, third tropic level, and so on. Man, tiger, lion, and such very strong animals, they usually occupy the top level in any ecosystem, in almost all the ecosystems. Friends, here, when you take an account of the nature, you'll come to know that this nature is actually the earth, you can say. We call earth as a green planet. Now, why this is so? Why our earth is green planet? Now, because it is fascinated with millions of plant species. You know that about 320,000 species of plants have been detected so far, have been studied so far. And all of them have been grouped into four broad categories of green algae, bryophytes, pteridophytes, and seed plants. Now, these plants, which increase the beauty of nature, beauty of earth, they provide us oxygen, which is the basis of all ecosystems on this face of earth. Apart from production of oxygen, the plants, they produce grains, fruits, vegetables, which form basic food items of human being. they are having the cultural importance, they are having some ornamental importance, they may be utilized for procuring materials for construction of buildings, writing materials, and even most of the plants, they have been used as a source of medicine, either in full or partially. Here, these like plants, there are so many animals which also contribute to the beauty of nature. So far, if you take an account of all the animals available on the face of earth, so described species and undescribed species of animals, the number goes up to 7.77 million. Such type of floral diversity and such type of faunal diversity, they are enjoying this green planet. Friends, when you consider such type of animal filth, you know that near about 15,25,000 species of animal species have been described out of 7.77 million. And human being has been using these animals for food, for procuring leather, wool. Some are being utilized as pet animals. Some animals are being utilized for the agricultural purposes to conduct the agricultural work. Some are used for hunting purposes, like your dogs. They are mainly used for hunting. And most of the animals, are hunted, used as the sport animals. Now here, such fascinating and very intact nature started deteriorating due to human activities, and that began during the ancient civilization and human beings had brought about their own collapse by abuse of environment, by the process of deforestation. You know that deforestation is simply slaughtering the trees, cutting the trees. So by deforesting their hillsides and eroding their soils, they had destroyed the natural fertility. Deforestation has been done. See, since hundreds of years, this process of deforestation is being done for the purpose of agriculture, for procuring the material for construction of building as a timber, just to convert it into charcoal or directly for fire. If you consider just a count of only 12 years, starting from year 2000 to 2012, you'll come to know that near about 2.3 million square kilometers of forest around the world were cut down. And such type of, these are all of the slaughtered trees who gave us millions of tons of oxygen to breathe. But what has happened to the nature? Very scanty greenery has been remained on the surface of this earth. So we are marching towards desert conditions. Friends, if you took an account of the environmental deterioration, you'll come to know that pollution, then the habitat destruction of wild organisms, and then extinction of wild animals has occurred since last several decades. And thus, we are contributing to the deterioration of environment through depletion of the quality of air, quality of water, quality of soil, where all these wild organisms live. See, this is one of the photographs I have deliberately chosen here to show you, because this picture, it shows a massive tiger hunt. See, here you may see that hundreds of people or the soldiers have been gathered over here with one king known as Maharaj of Alwar. See, this Maharaj of Alwar, he had organized one massive tiger hunt party for his British guests in 1926. And in this massive tiger hunt party, 300 soldiers and one dozen of elephants were participated. They encircled several areas of the forest, encircled the tigers, and they really killed them, shot down hundreds of tigers. And thus, the deterioration of the nature started. Friends, when you take an account of tigers across the world, see, I'm talking about the scenario of the tiger population in the year 1900. So 1 lakh tigers were present, were happily living on this planet Earth in the year 1900. But during next 8 decades, that is from 1900 to 1980, see, there was tremendous kill of not only tigers, but millions of wild organisms on the face of Earth. And what happened? That 3 important subspecies of tigers known as Bali tiger, Javan tiger, Caspian tigers, they became extinct due to the cruel role of human being. When you take an account, the Indian scenario with reference to wild organisms or the shooting of tigers and all other wild organisms, so you'll come to know that this process of shikar, which we call the sport or hunting of animals, that began with the Mughal Empire. Here the Mughals, they arrived in India in 1526, and their empire went up to 1857. So what happened during that period? Yeah, these Mughals, they introduced to this shikar as sport in a country. And initially, this shikar, it was actually the sport of only royal families. But what happened due to that? No doubt, several hundred wild organisms, including tigers, were killed with the help of swords and arrows. But very less damage was caused to the wild organisms because of the own limitations of weapons like sword and arrows. But when the improvement took place in the field of technology, and when guns were invented, so such deadly improvement of guns, they brought the tigers into more danger. Friends, this is one more picture I'm sharing with you. It is actually the hunting party in India with 5 tigers and 1 rhino in 1920. Friends, at the beginning of 18th century, these Europeans came to India with new technology, and they were real plunderers of wildlife in our country. They came with guns and explosives, and these guns and explosives were used extensively to kill such wild organisms, including our tigers. Now, these Europeans also came to India with their industrial mind. And you know that the process of industrialization usually loses love for nature. In 19th century, there were plentiful tigers throughout the Indian subcontinent when the number was 40,000. See, the number of tigers in the 40,000 at the beginning of 20th century in our country, but that reduced to less than 1,800 during the British Raj. And after our independence in 1967, here, by 1967, hunting had become a commercial enterprise, and most of the forests were accessible by jeep. Friends, if you look at this particular graph, it shows very steady decline in the population of tigers in India. Here, in 1900, the tiger population was, say, 40,000. But when you look at the last figure of 1972, last bar, you'll come to know that from 1900 to 1972, yeah, this decline was from 40,000 to 1,827 only. And this decline is what it was due to, see, this particular fact that how many tigers were killed by different individuals. So this table depicts the individual score of tiger shooting by some of the Maharajas and the British officers. Here the first score that goes in the name of Maharaja of Surguja, who killed 1,100 tigers. Then the Maharaja of Udaipur, who killed 1,000 tigers. Then the Maharaja of Rewa and Gauripur, who each killed 500 tigers. See, likewise, if you go down, you'll come to know that General Wardrop, who was one of the officers, British officers, he shot down 7 tigers. So thus, all these persons, they snapped to natural living link with our 5,000 years of history. And that's why in the year 1972, only 27 tigers, they remained in India. Friends, here, if you look at this particular chart, here, that is the tiger poaching estimates given by our Union Ministry of Environment and Forest. And then the Wildlife Protection Society of India and the NTCA, that is National Tiger Conservation Authority. Since 1999 up to 2016, how many tigers were killed? How many tigers were eradicated due to various reasons? That is been shown in this table. And you'll come to know that even after launching Project Tiger, so many tigers, hundreds of tigers were killed and died due to different reasons. Friends, India, that is the world's largest home for Royal Bengal tiger, which is said to be the national animal of our country. And this India is hosting more than 70% of the world's tiger population. See, I'll come to the particular PPT where I mentioned that out of total tigers, near about 4,000 tigers, 3,800 plus tigers are found. Of them, 70% tigers are found only in India. And that's why India is said to be the best home, largest home, ideal home for the tigers. Friends, last 70 years, they witnessed fall in the population of Royal Bengal tigers. That was, 40,000, as I told you, and it came down to 1,800. And to receive, to revive the population of tigers and to overcome such threat, what we did, we launched Project Tiger in our country. Here, when this Project Tiger was launched, this Project Tiger was launched in the year 1973. 1st April 1973, the launching of this project was done with the holy hands of the then Prime Minister, Mrs. Indira Gandhi. As a major wildlife conservation project in India, to enhance, to show the declining of our Bengal tigers. And it was launched from the Jim Corbett National Park, which is located in the state of Uttarakhand. See, while launching this project, the then Prime Minister, Mrs. Indira Gandhi, while addressing the nation, told that the tigers cannot be preserved in isolation because they usually occupy the top of all the entire complex biodiversity. They are at the apex of the complex biodiversity, and their habitats are being threatened by several anthropogenic activities which should be stopped. So during launching, our Union Ministry, they provided us grant of near about 50 million rupees. And this project was launched in collaboration with WWF and International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, that is IUCN, who contributed rupees 8 million towards the purchase of equipments, then expertise and study abroad. This was actually a very important conservation effort initiated to protect the tigers from poaching activities and other threats and to maintain their population. See, there were two basic aims. And to fulfill these aims, supportive three objectives were formulated. And one of them, one of the aims that was to ensure to well-maintain population of Bengal tigers in their natural habitats. And second was to maintain a viable tiger population for their economic, ecological, cultural, and aesthetic significance. To fulfill these aims, to bring the aims into truth, three objectives. See, unless we formulate certain objectives and to work in that direction, we will not fulfill our aims, we will not reach up to the aims. And that's why the first objective was to ensure limiting of any factor that is responsible for reduction of the habitats of tiger, just like converting forest land into agriculture, deforestation, poaching activity, or shooting activity, etc. So to ensure limiting all such factors. Second objective was, see, if any damage was done, or if any damage is done to the habitat of tigers, then it should be immediately repaired. So any damage is done to habitat should be repaired so that the ecosystem should remain in balanced state. And third objective was to maintain viable tiger population. Friends, in the initial phase, 9 tiger reserves were declared with a total population of 268 tigers. No doubt, 1,800 plus tigers were there in India in the initial state. That is in the year of 1973. But only 9 tiger reserves, such as Bandipur, Corbett, see, I have written all of them, up to Sundarbans, they were included in the first stage. And all these 9 tiger reserves, they were having the total population of tigers only 268. Later on, the Periyars, then the Sarikan, then Bandappan, and up to Tadoba and several others, they brought under the umbrella of this tiger reserves. Friends, this entire project of the tiger project that is handed over to the authority known as NTCA, that is National Tiger Conservation Authority. And this is the authority, the immediate supervising agency. It works as immediate supervising agency that administers it through 7 different units. See, for the easiest way of operation, here, this NTCA is working through 7 different units. One of them, that is the Eastern Ghats Conservation Unit. The second is the Western Ghats. Then the Central Indian Unit. Then the Northeast Conservation Unit, Sariska Conservation Unit, Kaziranga, Sivalika, and Sundarbans. All these units and all these reservoirs, they have been divided into 2 components. So if you consider any one tiger reserve, that tiger reserve is having very central area known as a core area. Now the core area of the jungle, of the forest, that is such an area which is known as the national park, or which is known as a wildlife sanctuary, and it is usually kept away from any human activity. See, human activity like tourism, that is totally banned from this area. If, say, you are not allowed to take your herds of cattle to graze in, or if you are not allowed to go for collecting fruits, collecting wood, and every such essential commodities from the core area. So it is best place for the wild organisms to thrive well. And this such core area is further surrounded by another area which is known as buffer zone. The buffer zone is developed around the core zone with 2 purposes, with 2 intentions. One of the intentions was this, that whatever wild organisms are enjoying in the core area, they should get some additional space, supplementary space to move. And that's why these wild organisms in the core area, they are also coming to the core area, which is supplemented habitat for them. And this buffer zone is also allowing human beings to conduct some limited activities. Here, you know that there are some nomadic people, nomadic communities, which are living in the forest. Their daily or routine activities fully dependent upon the forest produce. And that's why, to some extent, see, livelihood source for villagers are available in the buffer zone. So all tiger reserves, they have been divided into such 2 components. Friends, in the benefit, or for the benefit of tigers, see, tigers cannot be conserved in isolation unless you protect all other wild organisms, because there is a specific food chain. There's a very complex food web in the forest. So forest remains as a very good strong biodiversity area only if the tigers survive, because they occupy at the top of the food chain. And in order to strengthen all the ecosystems or these tiger reserves, the government has generated action plan with key principles. And these key principles are like this: that is, eliminating human interference from core area and careful rationalization of activities in the adjoining buffer area. Second, that is, limiting practices to only repairing ecosystem damage. Third important, that is, monitoring floral and faunal changes. You know that season-wise, the nature, the beauty of nature, beauty of ecosystem that goes on changing. Season-wise, during, if you look at the natures around, you may observe that this beauty is very different during monsoon than the winter season or than the summer season. So just to monitor floral changes and faunal changes, time over time for the research. Then to counter poaching, you know, though the government has been enforcing laws, has been generating, creating different acts at government level and trying to implement at ground level, even then, there are some poachers, there are some quail and human beings which usually go for poaching of wild organisms. And just to counter such poaching activities, government has tried their level best to develop very strong wireless communication system. Okay, so wireless communication system and outstation petrol cams have been deployed in the reservoirs. Then, you know, that another threat, that is of the fire. Fire within no time converts the thick forest area into very barren land. And just to prevent such deterioration due to forest to the ecosystems, it was decided to use some preventive measures, control measures to protect the forest, forest from the fire. That was one of the principles, to take some measures, preventive measures and control measures. Know that unless there is availability of ample of water, vegetation will not grow. And if there is no thick vegetation, the forest ecosystem will go on drying. And due to lack of water, not only tigers, but even all rest of the wild organisms, wild or forest animals, they will die off due to scarcity of water. And that's why government decided to create water holes, water facilities for the tigers and all wild organisms, wild animals and plants. Then integration of local people. See, government is trying their level best, but unless local people are giving cooperation, institutions, students, teachers, and the nature lovers, if they are not with this government, government policy will not come into truth. And that's why integration of local people through ecological development programs was another key principle of this action plan, and establishment of the interpretation center. See, whatever programs have been employed so far in order to secure, in order to protect the tigers and ecosystems, unless we take an account, we will not be that much successful in the tiger project. And that's why government decided to establish nature interpretation centers. Friends, with this, if you look at the history of this Project Tiger, at initial phase, only nine tiger reserves with total area of 9,115 square kilometer that was identified and brought under special protection task of the Project Tiger. Then in the year 1980, that means within the span of only 7 years, 15 more tiger reserves were identified, and the number increased to 15 with total area of forest cover of 24,000 square kilometers. And that's why in the year 1984, see, in 1973, the Project Tiger was launched, and immediately after the period of only 9 years, See, what was the number 268 initially, that number of tigers tremendously increased beyond 1,100. See, that was the success story of this Project Tiger. See, again, up to 1997, 8 more tiger reserves or forests were identified and converted into tiger reserve, and hence the total number of tiger reserves became 23 with total area of 33,000 square kilometers. Friends, today's position of this tiger reserve is this, that near about 50 tiger reserves have been identified by your government, and all these 50 reservoirs coming under Project Tiger, that is covering the total area about 72,000 plus square kilometers to remember. So that much green cover have been developed by our government. See, this home range of tiger, if you look at home range of tiger, now major part of our country has been covered by the home range of tiger. See, starting from Corbett, which is located at the foothills of Himalaya in the north, up to the Periyar Tiger Reserve in the south part of our Karnataka. See, and from Namdapha in the eastern part of our country up to the Melghat in western region of our country. So this much major part of our country has been covered as a home range for tigers. Friends, this launching of Project Tiger, that has encouraged very good results, because see, in 1980, what was the tiger population in our country, which was only 1,827, that number went up to 3,300 in the Indian subcontinent. So that is the outcome of the tiger reserve. Friends, if you look, take a very brief look on the tiger census, you'll come to know that in 2200, the number of tigers, including adult and sub-adult, that was 1,411. In 2014, that number went up to 2,226. And in 2014, the state of Karnataka was called state tiger state, because the number of tigers in Karnataka, that was higher as compared with any other state, and that was 408. But in successively later on, and when you consider the tiger census took place in the month of July 2019, so the status of the tigers, a number of tigers in our country, that is 2,967, where the state of Madhya Pradesh became the tiger state, because more than 500, that means 526 tigers have been detected, have been reported from only one state of Madhya Pradesh, followed by Karnataka, where the number of tigers, that was 524, followed by third state of Uttarakhand, where the number is 442. Now, the Madhya Pradesh state is said to be the tiger state of our country. Friends, as per the data released by WWF, Worldwide Fund for Nature, the total number of tigers, that is 3,890, that means around 4,000, approximately 4,000. Out of that, 2,900, that means near about 3,000 tigers, they are available in our country, and that's why India is said to be very ideal home for tigers. Friends, Project Tiger, which was launched in the year 1973, that has gained ecological, aesthetic, economical, and educational and research importance to our country, and that is the outcome of this project. I am very much thankful to all these three colleges for giving me this opportunity to interact with all my very beautiful and enthusiastic students. Thank you, one and all. Thank you. Over to controllers, Madam Pendurkar College. Due to time paucity, I was requested to wind up the lecture within 40 minutes. Do not take 1 hour. That's why I have taken this lecture rather hurriedly. So I hand over to Principal Mahajan sir from Pendurkar College.
Thank you, sir. It was not slowly conducted. It was very well conducted by you. Thank you for the very informative lecture to all of us and our students.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Hello, Darshana, madam.
हॅलो.
हा मॅडम, पुढचं सेशन आहे आता.
हो हो आहे, पण त्याला कनेक्ट करतो आणि ते एडिट करून टाक, लगेच लिंक करून टाकते आणि दुसरी जॉईन कर.
दर्शना मॅडम, मीटिंग लिव करू का आम्ही? कारण आता पुढचा पिरियड